Wilson disease is a hereditary metabolic disease in which the excretion of copper via the bile is disturbed. As a result, the metal accumulates in the body and causes disease. When treated, the prognosis is favorable.
Wilson disease is a rare disease that can easily be overlooked, as it can lead to hepatic symptoms and also neuropsychiatric symptoms. This means that either hepatologists and psychiatrists and also family doctors should think of Wilson disease.
The prevalence of Wilson disease is estimated to be 1 in 30,000. However, more recent data suggest higher frequencies. The disease becomes symptomatic between the ages of 5 and 40. Women and men develop the disease at about the same rate.
The defect in Wilson disease is in the Wilson protein. The Wilson protein is responsible for copper excretion in the bile. The Wilson gene is mutated in Wilson disease, and this leads to a dysfunction of the Wilson protein. Therefore, copper accumulates in the body. The other function of the Wilson protein is loading of copper on apoceruloplasmin. That means that as a side effect, ceruloplasmin is not loaded with copper, and that leads to degradation and low serum ceruloplasmin levels.
This leads to an elevation of free copper in the serum and deposits in several tissues, in the liver, in the central nervous system, in the erythrocytes, and in the cornea. In the eyes, the deposits lead to the formation of typical rings called Kaiser-Fleischer rings. This is pathognomonic for Wilson disease, but its absence does not exclude it.
The cause of Wilson disease is very different in the patients. Some small children already present with decompensated liver disease or only mildly elevated transaminases, so the cause of the disease is not predictable. We even know that patients can stay asymptomatic until older ages. Older patients can have mild symptoms and young patients even very severe symptoms. But the normal causes that you develop in your childhood or young adulthood, liver symptoms, neuropsychiatric symptoms develop a little bit later, typically 2 to 3 years later. So these patients are a little bit older than the patients that present with hepatic symptoms as first symptoms.
Many patients remain asymptomatic for decades. But sooner or later, most of them develop symptoms. Hepatomegaly may lead to a feeling of fullness, and in the further course, signs of developing cirrhosis may occur. Neurological manifestations can be tremor, dysarthria, dystonia, gait abnormalities, or drooling. On the eye, Kaiser-Fleischer rings can lead to a diagnosis of Wilson disease.
We think that about half of the patients have more predominant hepatic symptoms and half of the patients more predominant neuropsychiatric symptoms, and about 10% of patients even only having psychiatric symptoms. But the question is, how many patients are not diagnosed? And so we don't know the real number and the real distribution of the symptoms in the patients.
Regina fell ill at the age of 6. And had to stay in bed for 4 years. Only at the age of 10 was she diagnosed with Wilson disease. I fell ill as a 6-year-old, shortly after starting school, and just before Christmas. Over the next 4 years, there was a lot of diagnosing and a lot of treatment until the right diagnosis was made in 1976. Then the right treatment was initiated. During that time, I was in bed almost 100% of the time until the right diagnosis indicated that that had been total nonsense and had never been indicated.
Und nie indiziert.
Actually, The case is really typical. And when we ask our patients, our Wilson patients, to, in retrospect, tell us what was most important in their Wilson disease history, many told us that the main problem was that they were for so many years symptomatic and nobody thought on Wilson disease. And especially in children, they only start to get school problems and it's just nobody thinking on the disease. And that's why it's so relevant to really think on Wilson disease in unclear conditions. And the children just get tired and they don't perform so good in school. And it's even that nobody takes blood, and even the blood values are often not leading to diagnosis. So this is very typical.
The diagnosis of Wilson disease requires a combination of clinical findings, lab results, and genetic analysis. MR imaging of the brain can be helpful. A liver biopsy to determine the parenchymal copper content is only indicated in case of doubt, when a case is genetically unclear. Lab tests may show elevated transaminases, but not necessarily, especially in the neurological form. Ceruloplasmin and copper level in the serum are typically decreased, but copper in 24-hour urine elevated. This combination, together with the presence of a Kaiser-Fleischer ring, establishes the diagnosis.
Wilson disease is, let's say, in part quite easily diagnosed because we have five parameters to analyze, but it's in part very difficult to diagnose because every parameter can be normal in a patient and although the patient has Wilson disease. So what we analyze is serum ceruloplasmin, but only 80% of the patients having an hepatic cause have an abnormal serum ceruloplasmin. We in addition look for copper in the urine. We really have to send the patient to an ophthalmologist that looks via the slit lamp examination for this Kaiser-Fleischer rings. I really want to pronounce that you don't only look in the eyes of the patient if you see something, but you really have to send the patient to the ophthalmologist. And then if you really have the suspicion of Wilson disease, you have to go for liver biopsy, although you have a young patient and you have the risk of the procedure. And what is very relevant to really think of Wilson disease when planning the biopsy, because you need this dry biopsy. That means that you don't put it in your tube for the pathologist, because formalin fixation makes it difficult. Some say it's still possible to analyze copper in your fixed probe, but actually you need the dry probe. That means take the biopsy in a dry container and look for copper in dry weight. So in the sum, then you have to think if your picture of your parameters and the display, the whole collection of results is then Wilson disease or not. So it's always interpretation of the sum of the results.
The most important therapy is treatment with chelating agents. They form complexes with the copper in the blood, which are then excreted via the kidneys.
We have the chelating agents, d-penicillamine and trientine. D-penicillamine is licensed for the therapy of Wilson disease, and we typically start a patient on d-penicillamine, but we always have in mind the side effect of d-penicillamine, the neurological symptoms that can develop after start of d-penicillamine. As an alternative drug, we have the trientine. The trientine is now licensed by the EMA, but everybody should check in his country how the cost reimbursement is for trientine. Trientine has some advantages because the neurological side effects are less.
Zinc causes less copper to be absorbed in the intestine and can be used as an alternative to chelating agents.
Zinc is good because you have few side effects. You can usually preferentially use it in patients that have only mild symptoms or asymptomatic. But zinc is not as robust in its efficiency. That means that a patient has to be very compliant, and also in compliant patients, we see patients that over the course of the therapy don't get so good as under the chelating therapy. So your patients under zinc therapy, you should really check regularly, at least every 3 to 6 months, if the therapy is really working.
A copper-free diet is useful, but difficult to implement. And even with maximum adherence to dietary rules, it is not recommended as the only treatment. In very advanced stages, or in fulminant progression, liver transplantation may be indicated.
With a therapy, you can have really good results because you really remove the toxic agent, the copper. You, over the course of the time, you get a negative copper balance, and your patient can improve impressively. We have patients that were diagnosed in their young adulthood with decompensated liver disease, and after 1 to 2 years, they have an impressive improvement. And I have, for example, one patient who had really decompensated situation with esophagus variceal bleeding, and now she has 3 children and is healthy and is happy. So you can really have a good success, but only in your compliant patients, and especially for the hepatic symptoms. The neurological symptoms are not as easily improved, so you need a longer time till you see the improvement, and in part you need higher dosages of the medications.
Wilson disease is a rare disease that is often challenging in diagnostics and therapy, but timely diagnosis and consistent lifelong therapy are crucial for patients, because they enable them to live an unrestricted life expectancy and quality of life.
It's relevant to consider Wilson disease as a diagnosis and to consider really the whole diagnostic workup for Wilson disease, including the liver biopsy and also thinking for the dry biopsy. So that is the one very relevant thing. The second thing is really to look for the patient regularly and to connect with the experts if necessary, and don't prolong it. And you can find your experts in the ERN network and really get in contact with the doctors that treat Wilson disease patients more regularly.